Okay, hello, welcome back to Zoink TV. My name's Andrew Weir, and it's been quite a while since I've made a video tutorial, so I've not got any editing software either, so really just going to be a casual video that I go through this technique in relation to my latest project, and I just hope you guys learn a lot from it, and maybe you guys could use a similar technique for your games or Unreal projects. The main idea of the technique is to allow greater variation within one shader and to make it super easy for other artists just to bring in a new asset, bring it through Painter, texture it really quick with like a click of a button, make any tweaks that they might want to make, and then export it out. So I think it works pretty well. At the end of this video I'll go through more about what the project is, if you want to stick around for that, and generally where this channel's going to be going in the future. So right now we've got three rocks here, and I appreciate they don't look too different, but this one's more of a light orange, or you know, an off yellow sort of colour up here, with a sort of reddish gradient here. This one's got a reddish gradient going into a grey, and the edges are a bit sharper with a white line on them. And then this one here is it's the same as this one, but it's not got a gradient on it. So just showing a bit of variation that we can bring in from this shader. So it was created within Substance Designer first, so I would create this albedo texture or diffuse texture right here through Substance Designer. Nothing too complicated. It's pretty blurred, pretty quickly made, but it gets the job done. It's just a general bit of variation in the texture, and then this texture is thrown onto every single instance of the asset. So right now this is the default color, but then I've also in the alpha channel put in a grayscale version of the map, which allows me to lerp the values and then allow me to change the black here to any color that I want, and the white to any color and anywhere in between, obviously, with a lerp. So that's what I've been doing here, and that's how I get the colour to generally change. You can't really see it because this rock's quite small, but then the more I scale this rock up, the more that texture tiles. And then for greater variation, if I just bring this over here, I can also scale that texture over here. So I can scale that up and down, as you can see on this rock here. If I can add some greater scaling with that, and then I've got some stuff here. Again, I can turn the gradient on and off. If that compiles, I won't let that compile. But as you can see, that can turn the gradient on and off, as well as changing different stuff like the strength of the gradient, the edges' strength, the edges' color, and so on. So how have I created it? Through Designer. The top section here is creating that base color, albedo, diffuse, whatever you want to call it, and obviously that has been run through a gradient map here. So that's where I'm bringing out the base color that I wanted to bring through initially in my preview. And then from that point I've got my grayscale value, which I'm just putting through a RGBA or an RGBA merge, and I put that into an output, but I just did this for the tutorial right now. And then from that point what we've got here is different types of inputs, which are directly linked to the inputs that come through Substance Painter. So I'll put a link in the description to the documentation that says all the names of things, but it's pretty straightforward. If I want to input the AO and curvature, then on this input node I'll name it ambient occlusion, exactly like that. Again, that's in the documentation, just copy and paste it to get it exactly right, or just type it in if you know it. And then in the usage you will add the usage and you will put it down as ambient occlusion. So, and it's the base texture, so it's the one that immediately gets put onto the model once it's baked. And that's generally what paint is going to do anyway, because when you bake an ambient occlusion you're going to get that on. And really on these stylized models you don't need ambient occlusion, roughness and all that kind of stuff, but anyway. So from that point in Designer I would have a preview one, so I'd already bake a texture and then I would bring in my ambient occlusion just to test what it looks like, and I'd run that through the system and then just see what that gives me. I could put my preview model in here and again just see what the preview looks like while I'm creating this material, but I've already done that, and basically we've got these input nodes here. And then the next important step is what kind of output do you want. So after this point here I am putting a little switch here, which I've exposed the parameter of within Painter, so that I can switch between my base color, which is going to be my preview, and my secondary base color, which is going to be my map that I actually want to export from Painter, and that'll become more obvious when I actually get into Painter. And that is put down as a usage for base color, so that's the one that I'm going to see when it runs into Painter. And I've just named it RGB map because it's one of those RGB textures that's compressed in Unreal. So right there we've got an RGB A merge where I can combine different textures, and really I've taken advantage of every single baked texture that we can get out of this. So I've got my position map, which is going to give me a gradient, which is what I'm using for the gradient, but I've also subtracted some of the world space normal to make the tops a little bit brighter than the sides, but generally just going through and seeing what looks nice when I'm actually creating it. So that's really all I can show you in Designer. So I'm going to switch over to Painter, where I've got not the rock that I had in Unreal, because that rock wasn't actually created by me, so I don't actually have the low poly and high poly for that, but the texture was. That was so that was the first rock that I textured to test out this technique, but showing how it can work on something different. What I would do is I would, well, I'm just going to check if I've got the generator already. So I haven't brought the generator in yet, which is good, so I'm going to just bring it in for you guys, have a little look. So from Painter here I would hit the this export button here to get the SBSAR file, and that can be dragged into Substance Painter quite easily. So I'm just going to find that in here. These are my assets, textures, rocks, and I've got that rock master generator, which I can open Painter here, get my rock master generator, drag it in. You can put stuff in there if you want, like just to easily find it. I'm going to put it in the generator section. I'll put it onto my current session, and the preview's loaded now. We can see that that's basically what it's given me there. You can see the ambient occlusion's working, got the base texture on there. And if what I do at this point, or any other artist would do, is they would have this on their shelf already. So nobody needs to worry about edit, so every other artist doesn't need to worry about the previous process going through designer. All they need to do is have this on their shelf, bake the textures. So I'm going to bake just a quick texture here. I hope that I've picked the right high poly because I haven't really tested this out. But I'm going to bake that. See what we get out of that. So that looks alright to me. I can go on my shelf again and I can add a fill layer. I don't need to touch it, I can just add a generator and then I can either click here and select that, or I can just drag and drop that into there, and now I've got a half decent textured rock. Again, this is how we originally wanted the rocks to look, sort of this sort of colour, but in the end, due to how this is created, we did not have to have it like this. So what I've done here is I've got a little switch, which again is this little switch here, which is gonna swap my preview, which is right here, into my RGB texture, which is acceptable in Unreal. So RGB switch, and it's gonna look a little bit funky, a little bit weird, but from that point I can go to export textures and just set up my own export thing, which I've not done here because I've done this in a different computer. But I can set up my own export, and what I want to bring out of this is my normal map and my RGB map. So I don't need any of the other materials because the ambient occlusion is going to be on the diffuse map. Every other aspect is all done through the through the shader in Unreal. So I can go into Unreal and I can see that here are my inputs. I've got my albedo just in case I wanted to do it for a different texture. So I've got stuff like my structures which run through the same system. So I can change the texture out for that. My normal map, which again is a per shader per object thing that needs to be changed, so I can bring in a normal map per rock, and then my RGB map, which is giving me these different channels. So I don't know how optimized my master shader is, but just have a quick look at it. Past that point, here is how I scaled. You get the object scale. I've divided by 2 so that it does it less, so it doesn't scale so quickly. But that's how I'm scaling the albedo map based on the scale of the object. But really, what we want here is we've got the input for the RGB map, and then I've got various different multiplies and powers, which generally do the things that they say. So they just add the strength or gradient power just to be able to scale these things, and then they're clamped so that they don't fall outside of 0 to 1, and it's all fed in through a lerp. So these right here, these different maps, which I can have a little look at, these act as gradients. So I can put them into a lerp. I can lerp that colour, lerp in a colour, so the edging colour is getting lerped in, the AO colour lerped in, gradient colour, again stacking on top of each other. And then in my final result I get to the different sort of materials that I can instance, and that means I can just completely change. Let's say if I grab, I'll grab this one, So I can change my AO color to something like a green, maybe could appear to be a bit more of a mossy sort of situation. Again, these don't even have to be colors either. We can input textures into these different slots. If I just turn up the, there's the green coming in. The edging, maybe make that like a red or a pink apparently. You know, you can see that's coming in, and then the gradient, let's make that a blue, a light blue. And that doesn't seem to be coming in or out, so it does work though. Then also my albedo here, we can change that to a little switch here which uses the alpha as described earlier, which means that then again I can change between two colors. So if I just change this gradient to, because it's working again now for some reason, if I just turn that off pretty much, then I can grab, just, you see these dark points here are the original dark points, so I can scale that up, see this texture, and I can just maybe make that like a green, just so we can try and see that we are controlling the high and low points of that albedo map. So again, through this sort of variation is how we ended up texturing all the rocks within the game. So I'll just have a quick fly through. We've got different rocks coming in at different points, and all we needed to do was bake them in Substance Painter, throw the generator on, and then export that, bring it into Unreal. So that's two maps per object. Yeah, so I hope that helps. Again, this project's going to be at the Eurogamer Expo in Birmingham. If you want to come check it out, then that'll be great. As far as this YouTube channel goes, I'll be going through different projects, giving more tutorials in the future. I do need to maybe think of a way that I can get support on that, so maybe doing live streams or doing a Patreon. So if anyone's interested in seeing tutorials or interested in following me on Patreon to give me tutorials, I could probably set that up just to generally see what's going on there. But anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.